Hello everybody, my name is Michal Čihař and I'm author of a tool called Weblate, which is there to help you with the localization. I will first start with a simple question. How many of you do know Weblate and how much I should introduce it, or I can go to the deeper details? Okay, so how many of you know Weblate? Okay, good. Almost everybody. So I will do just short introduction for those who don't know. It's web-based localization tool. It was built to may have great version control integration so that you can connect it directly to your version control repository like Git or Mercurial or even Subversion if somebody still uses that. And its focus on providing translator good context about what they are doing so that they can do proper translations. And another main focus is to be able to automate most of the workflow so that the developers don't have to care about how to get the localization into the repository or the translators don't have to care about that as well, so that the process is fully automated. When you want to start using Weblate, you have to get the initial translation, assuming you have already something into Weblate. The easiest approach is to start from the version control repository so that you just point Weblate at it and it will look into the source tree and it will try to find localizable files like getText, PO files, Android Trezor strings, or whatever are you using. And we are trying to make best guess what you actually want to do with the files, because there are some configuration options and some workflow differences, so it still might need some manual tweaking, but in most cases it should do the right thing automatically. We support something like 30 formats. It's still not everything what is being used in the wild, so we are still missing some popular formats like XLIF2, which is not really the same thing as XLIF1. There's Fluent, which is used by Mozilla, which is also not supported, and there are about 20 of JSON variants which are not supported, but we support only 5 of them right now. It's common problem that every framework tends to invent its own localization format, and yeah, it's nice that you have something on your own, but it usually ends up that you repeat the same mistakes as everybody else did before. So you don't do then proper localization, you cannot add some context into the format, then you start adjusting the format to handle it in some not so clean ways, and that's where everybody should stop and start using something standard. But it's not that usual, especially in the web front-end scenarios where there are a lot of new formats being used and they all repeat the same mistakes. So when you will start with importing project, you will see something like this. This is a demonstration project, so it's not really a real code, but we can see there are some getText, PO files, some Android strings. So you just choose whatever you want to use and you end up with it being imported into Weblate. One of the first things which happens during the import, and this is why it sometimes takes too long, is that we have quite a lot of quality checks that try to detect common mistakes in the translations. They detect things like format strings in compiled language is frequently used to build up messages, or XML markup like placeholders in Android or XLIF files. And all these things are configurable by flags. So what happens when you have something wrong is you will get some thing to check. This time it's Python format. Maybe you can see that it's not present in the check translation while it was present in the source. And the thing how Weblate looks into that is that it parses the PO file, and it this particular string had I can think it's called type flex in PO file. It's a Python format, and then it can recognize that this should be actually the format string for Python, because otherwise it might be also format string for other language, which at this simple level is quite same, but it for more complex format string it can have different syntax, so then it can do the proper detection for various extensions used in Python, C, JavaScript, or whatever framework you are using. These flags are used to customize the checks, and besides the one which are already present in the translation files for formats that support it, you can define them also on the Weblate side. So you can do things like defining length of the strings, how regular expression to do whatever checks you might want to do, or doing other defining other markup which can be used, like for example BB code or whatever it can be. In this case, we have added a flag in Weblate that defines maximum length of the string. It defines, and again it fires the check here. So you can extend it basically on a string level, how a Weblate will behave on a string level. The other thing which is important for translators is to know what actually are they translating. In many cases, it's not obvious what actual string is being used. Is it used as a button, or is it label on some list? And in many languages, the translation would be different then. So one of the things where this can be specified is in the translation file already. Like getText is really good in that it has several ways to define additional context. The JSON files are typically very bad in that, because JSON doesn't support comments, so you cannot edit there if the format doesn't have defined it. So it depends on format how you use, but you can always define additional context inside Weblate. So then it's shown just next to the source string, so that it's clear to translator then when this actual string is used and what the %s actually stands for. That really helps to make the translation proper later. other side. But providing text is nice, but it sometimes can take long to write all the strings. But it's really helpful to provide screenshots. For example, for mobile applications, it's really helpful to see that what all is on the screen and how all the strings fit together. So that's when Weblate can upload the screenshots. It are shown just in the source information again, and you can link all the strings to the screenshot. You can upload any number of the screenshots and assign them to the strings. This can be also automatic using OCR, so that you just have to confirm the matches, but mostly it works fine. And then you have some screenshot management interface where you can put them and assign them to the strings. I have shown already limiting the length of the text, but that was counted in the characters. And that's what would help you on a terminal, but not in a proper UI. Because in UI, you are using typical variable width fonts, and the things get rendered differently. And also depends whether you are using some Latin fonts, where fonts letters are relatively narrow, or you are using Chinese, where letters are basically square-shaped. So it isn't that useful to have limiting in length of characters, but actually it's usual to have limits in pixels so that it's the rendered text can be fit into the screen. So one of the recent additions into Weblate was that we have fonts management, so we can upload the fonts, group them in some virtual groups. The reason for this is that many applications use different fonts in different languages, because you have different fonts for Arabic, for Chinese, for Latin letters, and you need that to switch them properly, so there's additional layer of what we call font groups. So you define basic font and you can then overwrite it per language. And it then show, again, can be configured through the flag. So we know we have that we are using font family called source that was defined on the preview screen. We are defining the size and we say that it should fit into 35 pixels, which it doesn't. And the check now shows here the rendered text and the border where it's supposed to fit in. So we see in this case that we should use some shorter name for the month and not the full name to fit into the desired space. Another thing which is helpful in these situations and was introduced in last release, or will be introduced in next release, but it's already part in our sources, is thing we called shapings. If anybody has better name, we can still change that. It's way to group different lengths of the same text. The example here is day of month or day of week. So you can use just one letter in case you are really tight in space, then you have some short name and then you have the full name which you use in big screens or if you have a lot of space. And shapings is a way to group these strings for translators so that they can see. The grouping is done by regular expressions. So it's quite flexible, but it's not that easy to configure, but it turned out that this is really the only way to do it because there is no standard at all. Even within the same frameworks, it depends on how the application authors write it and use these strings, so it really has to be as much flexible as possible. So, and what happens then that you will see all these here in the shapings, and it's also show indicated in the things to check. Like, because it's some kind of important thing which you might want to look at. But the workflow is not the same for all the projects. That's why we introduced concept of add-ons. This allow you to customize how the workflow works. It brings additional automation. It can help you integrate with third-party services, and they also configure how the file formats are handled, or especially how the translation files are generated, because in some cases you might want to enforce some additional rules, like you don't want to strings to be broken on certain width, but you want to have them unlimited width because your parser for the file is stupid and cannot deal with that, or different kinds of things. This is set of add-ons you can use on JSON file format, for example, in this case. The list of add-ons depends on the format and content of the repository, because we have integration with getText, like updating the linguas files and similar things. So it depends on what actually is in your repository stored. And depending on that, you can install and configure the workflow to fit your needs. One of the add-ons which is quite useful for big projects is component discovery. In that case, you don't have to manually configure a lot of components, but you can define the mask again using the regular expressions. It's not the most user-friendly thing, but it's quite flexible way. So you just define that you have some structure with language and component name, define parameters for the components, and you will end up with component in Weblate for every chapter of a book. Like in this case, it's localization for the Debian handbook, and all these components can be created automatically with just single discovery, so that you don't have to manually deal with that. But we want to also save the translator some work, and we have thing called machinery. That's our interface to machine translation and translation memory services. In last year, we have introduced built-in translation memory, which is still has some quite some areas to improve, but we have something which is more or less working. But it's also interface to many third-party services like Google or Microsoft and DeepL and whatever services you will realize. It's quite easy to add integration with another thing, so we receive contributions for another interfaces. So we have support for some Chinese services, which I even don't know how to configure properly and so on. And besides doing this manually, you have also option to use the machine as an add-on. And then it's executed automatically when new strings appear on the repository. It's gone through machine translation or translation memory, and you can get translation automatically or suggestion for translations, because with machine translation you probably want the human to review the strings later, not to accept them automatically. So that's option as well. And this is how it shows up in the interface. It shows lists from all the services. There are some matches inside Weblate. There are matches from third-party services as well. And they are sorted based on some quality, which is determined by either the source. So we trust some of the machine services more than the others, or by percent of matches in case of translation memory. And that's the basic thing I wanted to show out. And in the tall description, there was one question. If somebody wants to get his project hosted on hosted Weblate, then it might be the chance right now. If nobody here wants to do that, we can pick up one from our queue and do that online so that you can see how it actually works to being added on Weblate and how you can start translating that. So is there anybody here? No.
We already have it. You were asking for an existing project.
Yeah, if you have a project that you want to have translated on Weblate.
Yeah. All these language files are like JavaScript arrays.
Yeah, like JSON or? JavaScript code, okay, then it probably won't work. What?
They are not translating yet?
No, but they won't translate.
Okay, so we want projects that actually want to use Weblate, not projects you want them to use Weblate. Okay, I will.
Here, I'll stop by there. Like a glossary or so on?
We don't have any support for that. There may be API to do that, but it's not currently supported.
Glossary.
Unless you have thousands of them, it's quite easy to just download the TMX files from TransFX and upload them into Weblate.
Yeah, but you miss all the messages and bugs and communication which surrounds the translation.
Yeah, that's true. A vibration, co?
Jo, musím si... ...1072. Respektive... ...LK, možná ti to tady můžu nechat takhle. Tenhle se, on je tam možná i někde předtím. Když bude přes 1082, tak tam budou oba tikety.
Tady.
Tady koukni. Jo.
Okay, so we have randomly chosen from our queue something which is waiting there for 1 month, which is not that nice. So we will start with creating a project, and the thing is called LKY8000. Never heard of that before. Hopefully that it's something useful. LK8000. So the most important part of importing the translation is choosing the name and specifying the version control repository. Let's see if nothing breaks. It should now look in.
It's something useful.
What?
It looks to be something useful.
What is it?
A technical flight computer. It's a flight computer information for pilots.
Okay, nice. And it actually did something, and it did find out that there are some Android translation files. So we are choosing that one. And it shows now the summary of the project. And as it's going to be public, the last thing which I need to specify is license for this thing. And let's look GPL2. And we can keep rest of the settings on the default ones because it's what we will want. Ah, it was fast. We are now presented kind of localization guide that helps us to configure Weblate properly. It tells to include more context, like screenshot of flex to indicate something special in the strings. There should be some guidelines for the translator so that they can know, for example, who to ask when the new thing will be released and so on. Or where is some discussion forum for the project and so on. And then there's version control integration so that we can configure the flow automatically. But that's not something we need to do right now. And why it's only English here? Let me check the source code. Actually, they do have. Okay, they don't have another translation yet. So the only thing which is shown here is the source strings. And there are only 3 strings. So that's not probably the best project to choose.
I found out where is the problem in a support ticket, so let's move to another project. Basically, this is how, as we offer to all Libre projects, the free hosting service, because if you choose to use Weblate with your project, you can download and start your instance and do it all on your own. Or you can use our hosted service, and if you have open source project, you can use it for free. And this was a request that came from the maintainer, from the creator of this program, and he was really he really can't wait to have it done. So I asked Michal to done it right now, and I realized that they completed the email that there is no compatible format yet, and they are ready to patch. So they are ask for something to do before they do their work. So I'm sorry for the bad showcase that I chose.
Okay. We should have. What? Better untest, okay.
So how does your hosted service interface with your code? Do you push it back?
The question was how to push changes back from the hosted service. Basically, there are two options, or three. You can do it manually. It exports the repository, which is underneath, so you can just merge it as remote repository. You can give it access to push directly to your upstream repository. So it can push to GitHub or whatever you are using, or we can do a pull request with the translations. It's supported on GitLab and GitHub and Bitbucket, I think. So on these services, we can do a pull request as well, so that you can do whatever review you want to do on the language. The thing is that the developers mostly don't know the language, so it's just an illusion that you are doing some review on that in most cases. Because when you get Arabic translation, you see, okay, this looks like Arabic, but that's what most people are able to do with that, not review whether it's done properly. So, but you can do that if you want.
But in the web interface, you do have a review like that the translators can do themselves.
Yeah. The question is that
Arabic speaking people can.
Yeah, you can do the review inside Weblate, but some people want to have a tight control what goes into the repository, so they are doing some kind of review there as well. So, any other questions, or should I try another demo? Yeah, the question was whether it's possible to customize the processing of translations with add-on. Yes, you can do that. Basically, add-on is piece of Python code you can hook to several locations in the workflow, so that you can customize it from the thing when new string appears in Weblate until the things get committed into the internal repository. So you can do pretty much anything there. Sorry?
If I'm not addressed by the project, then I have my own translation memory from other projects or other systems.
Yeah, you can import it. There are three levels of translation memory. You can import it to your personal translation memory so that only you see that. You can import it into project translation memory so that everybody who is translating this particular project can use that. And there is also global translation memory, which is shared among the projects. That's on hosted installation, it's opt-in. You have to agree that you will contribute to that. And then everybody can use that. And you can, in turn, use translation memory from the others as well who have opted in for that. So let's try another demo. Maybe it will be. Untis. So again, some kind of Android application. So the setup is pretty much same as what we did before. It's just GPL version 3 this time. It takes longer, so it will be probably more strings there. And at least there is one translation as well. So we now have English and German strings. Most of that are translated. There are some failed checks. We can review that, what has been there. One of the things is unchanged translation. Then it's obviously its name, but we cannot know that. So we can do dismissing that for all languages. What happens in the background is that this sets a flag on the string that it should ignore some check. So if I reload the inter... Oh, okay. I did a gun gain. This is another thing which Weblate can check, that it tells you that the thing is translated as a question, but originally it was not. It was ending with a full stop. And in German it's translated as a question. That might not necessarily be a problem, but it usually indicates that either the original string is wrongly phrased, so that it should be questioned as well, or somebody should look at the translation whether it shouldn't be the same meaning as the original. Here it's really like that, and in English it says that this will do something, and in German it says, are you sure that something will happen? So it has a really different string, and it indicates usually some problem in the source string. Yeah, this is again similar thing with the strings, and yeah. So this is not good cases. So we have imported the project, and people can start translating it. If there would be some string to translate, it's not right near. We can start new language. For most formats, it can be done automatically. So let's translate this application into Czech. You can go one by one, but if you are working on the long text, you might actually want to see a Zen mode, which shows just one string next to each other. It doesn't show that much of context, but it's good for translating like new projects or where you already know the area and you want to just focus on translating the strings. So that you can just write the translations and you don't have to look at two other things, then it's way more effective than using the full interface. And it just loads all the strings in the background until you scroll to the end. Okay, that should be pretty much it. It will, the question is how well Weblate will push the things back, right?
Yeah, but I've had some people who contributed by changing the language files instead of using Weblate.
It will, okay. You can do changes on either side. If Weblate is properly linked to the Git repository so that it gets notified when the repository changes, it loads the translation from the Git as well. and it presents them in the interface. If in case there is conflict, you will get a merge conflict notification and you have to deal with that manually. But as long as something different is being changed, the things are just get merged on a Git level, and you can use it on both sides. What you can also do is download the translation file from Weblate. You can also download in different format than the project is using. Do the translation offline and then upload it back, and Weblate will merge it automatically. Even the upstream has changed meanwhile, it will merge the strings properly into the translation. So it can work offline on both sides. You can work on the repository side as well, but you can also download the translation files for offline use and upload it back later.
So directly from Weblate?
Yeah, you can, if I go back to the Czech translation, I can download in files. It can convert it into a bunch of standard formats, which are useful. You can also download the original file. The nice thing here is that if you download the original file here, you will get just the monolingual file. So basically, you get just ID and the translation. So you don't actually see the source strings there, but all the download options are for bilingual translation files, so that you have also the source string there integrated. So it's way better for offline translation than the original format. And you can also download all the strings which need to be translated, so you don't have to, if there is just half of the strings missing, you don't have to download the whole translation file, and just the ones which need translation. And then anything you download here, you can then upload back, and it will get merged depending on how you can configure it, depending on how sure you are with the translation. So you can upload it and overwrite existing things, and or just do replace the strings which are not translated here.
So I used Prutal before, and I kind of hacked something in there to allow my application to download an XML file with all the translations, and the last time they had been updated, so that in the application you go update translation and you just download the old file from Weblate. So is there something like that possible?
Yeah, all
the list of languages of my application.
Yeah, there's
the last time they were.
We have REST APIs, you can get all the information.
Okay.
What you cannot do yet is push all the information there. It's not possible to write some of the things, but you can download everything from the API. So,
okay.
Yeah, you can list that there are these languages, how much are they translated. You can download the original files or the converted one. Basically, the same options as I have shown in the UI, it's in the API as well.
Question, but I just wanted to say that I love you because we use Weblate Open Refine, and it's just great. I never have to think about it; it just works perfectly. It brought loads of contributors to the project. It's really, really amazing. So thanks you.
Thanks. Okay, they're back.
When I'm working a project, an existing project from GitHub, let's say, I noticed there is a field for a branch that should be important. How does it work? How do you support multiple branching models?
You can. The question is how Weblate integrated with different branches on Git. You can have any number of components, each can match to a branch. For example, if I look at PHP MyAdmin project, you can see that they are translating 4.9, 5.0, and development branches. So the translations are committed to each of them. What happens in Weblate is that when it sees the same string in all the components, it will translate them in all of them. You can switch this off, but this is what happens by default. So that the translator usually work on the latest one, but the translations get automatically propagated to other branches as well. What then needs to be handled is merging. If you do some maintenance across the branches, you need to handle the merging on the Git side then, because the original translation files which are being changed are typically different in each branch, and you cannot then merge them automatically, so you need to use some tricks with Git to skip Weblate changes from the other branch. But that's in more detail described in the documentation, how to do this.
When I went through this step, I should import every single branch as a new component in Weblate.
If you want all of them to get localized, then yes. What you can do then, there is simplified interface for importing different branch of the project, so that you just choose, if I think I can show it. Okay, it looks like network is not working that well now, but there is an interface where you can just choose additional branch to translate, and it will create the component for that automatically, so you don't have to go through all the configuration steps manually, but you just select the branch from the one which is configured. Okay, we have that.
How does this propagation work then? It works from component to component?
Yeah, it works on a component level in Weblate, so whatever you import there, it's translated. This can be used not only for the branches, but for example, if you are translating Android and iOS application, and you have the same strings there, it can be used to translate them at the same time as well. So it's not only useful for branches, but for translating different flavors of one project, for example.
Just compare English origin with another English
origin. It's based on the keys as well, so it's not only about the strings. It depends on the format. If you are using getex, then in most cases they're just source string. But if you are using key value based formats like with Android or iOS apps, then it looks on the keys as well. So it compares these as well.
And for getex, it takes also care of message ID, message string, and flags as a whole.
Yeah. Yeah, the message context is there as well, for if you are using that.
If and when are you going to implement two features? First, showing the changes per project and per language, because currently it's that I can only see the changes in every language. And I, for example, don't speak any Mandarin, so I would like to filter that. And the other feature, have an overview of the translators and reviewers in the project, so that when I'm adding a translation in a certain language, I know who's working on that language and can add them in the project.
Okay, so there are two questions. First of them is when we will support browsing history for languages and projects. Is that correct? It's already there. If you go from the project language page, you can go to the history and to go as much deep as you want. The thing is that you just need to go from that page. If you go to check translation of Weblate. It looks like I have problems with internet, but never mind. This one should work. I will probably show it later. The other question was about more detailed statistics of contributors and project. Yeah, we don't have that right now. You can dig it to some level in a history. So that's what I show now. If you go to the history and you can go browse all changes, or you can also construct the URL manually, but in the URL you can see it shows changes in project and for language. So it's already there, that interface. And for getting up the contributors, you can use a reporting feature, but it will just list you all the contributors in a project, I think. We don't have that from lower levels.
Mostly if you want to have something more, the greatest approach is if you are a programmer, just make a PR. Or if you have a specific idea how it should work, but you are not able to code it, just make an issue on our GitHub and we'll see. We are so happy if the real users are able to tell us what they are looking for.
Some languages have different regions where they're being used, but are exactly the same language. For example, Netherlands in the Netherlands, or sorry, Dutch in the Netherlands, Dutch in Belgium, Dutch in Curaçao, Dutch in Aruba. So some people who are starting translations may be importing already files that have NL underscore BE, and then later on we have to ask them, and it gets split up, so people make a translation for the Netherlands, translation for Belgium, and but they actually mean the same translation. Could your system maybe give a warning for certain combinations of languages and areas that you might want to switch to only using NL or whatever is relevant for that language, because in the end only one translation is desirable?
The question was, just to repeat it, the question was about doing translation for some language variants like Dutch and Dutch spoken in Belgium. The question is how to limit it, because in some cases it's really intentional that people want to add this, and we don't want to force some strict politics on this. So the option is there, and if you have some contributor who wants to translate into that crazy language, I would say, okay, let him do that. It might be useful for somebody in the end.
Well, most cases that I come across it is that people just didn't realize that it's actually the same language and it's not a political issue at all.
Okay.
Yeah, but it depends very much on your project, though. Because
yeah, that also.
In many cases, I have Argentinian and Spanish, and actually people really consider them different.
Yeah, for example, Brazilian and Portuguese.
Exactly.
Yeah.
There's a very
different.
But I'm not going to go into politics. Officially, it's the same Dutch language, but of course you have regional variations. But for the translation, it's not only for Dutch, but there are more of these languages where unintentionally multiple translations start and a lot of resources get.
Okay.
For maybe two or three translations.
We are trying to do this for some languages, but I think the rule for Dutch is not there. So if you think it makes sense, then please open up an issue, because we have list of language definitions. It's in separate repository, and it might make sense to add this rule there. Because yeah, it's for us, it's in most cases we don't know the languages as well. So, and Weblate has definition for something like 500 languages right now. So yeah, whatever.
Yeah. Like make a warning, not like enforce
yeah.
to be that of it, but just make people aware of that. And if it's okay, I have two more questions. You integrate stuff like language tool or spell checking, or you leave that to the browser?
The question is about spell checking. We were thinking about integrating language tool, but we are not yet there. So right now we are leaving it up to browser, but we might eventually integrate with language tool. That's certainly on the list, because we want to have that for all users, not just for those who might have some extension installed. But yeah, it's one of the features which might be implemented.
Contact Daniel, he's really happy to discuss what might be the best way to do that. Or
yeah, okay. I think I was in touch with him some time ago. Because I think the language tool is actually using Weblate for localization as well, so.
And for the people
word list, the frequency list of words for certain languages, for all the translation in that language? Or should I make an issue for that?
You can certainly download all the files and do whatever you want with them. But yeah, I don't think we will add specific support for this, because it's quite rare use case. Yeah, it's not like it would be costly to implement, but I don't think anybody else would use it than you.
Yeah. So maybe we will implement that and ask you how to do that the best way.
Yeah, okay.
I've been building on the voice app, a Google action for Google Home. And for voice output, I noticed that it is nice to have several variations. For example, I have to ask, do you want to know anything else in the sentence? So I have in Dutch like 7 variations of that. And in the translation to English, maybe that's 3 variations or 10. There is no cat tool I know of that can handle that. So what I want to do is to translate a group of 3 or 4 variations into another number, because in another language, it may be easier or more difficult to come up with variations. And also, I don't need a translation of every variation I created in Dutch. I need a group of variations on the same intent.
You mean like when the question's in different gender, so that you need to...
No different gender. If I do a voice conversation with a user from a robot, if I ask every time, is there anything else I can do for you?
Okay.
So I ask randomly, I choose, can I do anything else? Is there anything else I can help you with? Would you like some other questions to ask? So in Dutch, I have 7 variations for that to make the interaction with the user more natural.
Okay.
Which is typically for voice, I think, because in screen you don't do it. But I don't know of any cat tool that can help with that.
Well, what you can sort of do is use the shapings I've mentioned. So you can group the things together. But it will still be like you need to have the same amount of them as in the source language. But the shapings can help you at least to group them together so that it will be presented as related strings.
Yeah, but it helps.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Like, this is more a question maybe not for you, but maybe someone else. How do other language communities handle these language variations? Because I'm sure for some languages the differences are quite subtle, and you can, like, with only a few exceptions, share like maybe 90% of the language strings. Is there any support for that in Weblate? Or do you know how some languages handle this, some translation projects?
You mean like this kind of variations?
Yeah, this kind of variations. I don't know about Dutch as spoken in the Netherlands and in Belgium, but like, for example, for some languages, it's some spelling and a few words that are different. But I would guess that maybe 90% of the strings are identical.
So
yeah.
There's a wiki in the community in which this gets written down, how translation is done, or like, we use these words, we avoid these words and so on, and that's usually done in different sorts of wikis or documents outside of tools like this. But if a tool provides a way to do that,
well, this is already supported in GetText itself. If you make empty translation file, for example, for British English, if you will translate only those different strings, then GetText will join both files together to create a correct translation.
Okay, so will it use, like, which one will it use if you have English as spoken in the US and Australia and in the UK?
Yes.
Is it the one that in English that is in? Which one is
it? It parses the language, language name. For example, if you have, say, P, no, as underbar mx mx, so then it's
first
checks for local specific strings, and if they are empty, then it checks for Spanish strings. So this is a mechanism specific to get
text. Yeah, we have feature request to do this kind of thing in Weblate as well, in some way, but it's not yet implemented, and I even don't see a nice approach to that, because it leads to duplication of the strings in both translations, and then it's quite unsure when you change the strings in the leaf translation whether they should be propagated to the parent one or not. So you would have to ask the translator, is this change just for your variant, or should it be done on the parent level as well? I think we are running out of time. So thank you, everybody, for your attention. If you want to discuss something more, you can join us for a beer tonight. If you want to do it in a more civilized way, you can join us in a booth yesterday. And you can find more information on our website. Thanks for your attention.